the most practical step in that direction was people were encouraged to remote. People were encouraged to, if they felt to cry, or if they were angry, to speak out and to be angry, or if they were aroused and to take hold of or breath, whether they were taught back their emotional responses, or in, if you use the more psychoanalytic processes, they were taught free association, which in the cognitive brain was the same as letting yourself be emotionally free. But I began to learn the truth of the matter is that a spontaneous response being taken over by one's own inherited processes was not always the best way for the organism to mediate itself. And I noticed that people were always frightened of losing control or giving control away or not being able to influence themselves and didn't quite know what to do. And so I said, hey, wait a minute. People who are crying don't necessarily feel sad, but people who are beginning to sob, they feel sad, and then they're overwhelmed by the feeling, and they miss the action. So what if I say to somebody, well, it's good that you feel like crying, and how do you hold up the action of crying? Now, do you want to cry, or do you want to do something with what you recognize may be inappropriate, that would not be formative for you, but wipe out your, although you would feel good? And I would say the same thing about anger. How would you then disassemble the pattern? So that I saw, wow, people don't mind feeling sad or angry. They don't want to act it out or be a victim to it. Mm-hmm. So then I saw that it took voluntary effort to manage the muscular urge, the muscular pattern, muscular neural pattern of crying. And then you have voluntary influence on an instinctual pattern, mm-hmm. in which you use your response and the pattern as a way of making it something that is under voluntary management. I am saying, I don't want to cry, but I feel insulted, so I don't have to cry. I may want to say, please don't insult me, or I may want to say, no, I don't really feel sad. What I feel is I don't know another way to address this dilemma. I try to understand, well, in the methodology, first is, you see, not to think of it as a methodology. I think of it as a function.
Oh,
I don't think of it as a method. I think what I'm trying to teach a person is the nature of a function. And if they see the five steps as a sequence of steps in a function, as they learn to use that function, it becomes habituated and not a tool or a method, but a way of behaving, but your way of behaving. Mm-hmm. So when you understand that there are developmental steps and that a person will use voluntary effort to use a muscle as a way to initiate entering a force in their own body so that they mobilize, let's say, being startled, and then how they increase the startle mechanism by the intensification of their own effort, and how they then step back and use less effort and let other experiences shape come to the foreground in which shapes they will muscularly and cortically support. They are building a function in them that makes it habituated and makes it a natural way to address problems. Mm-hmm. It's not applying, it's mm-hmm. not like learning meditation. Mm-hmm. It is like learning to use the cortical voluntary tracts of muscular influence and the involuntary muscular acts below the cortex. And is a way, so it's a function. Being formative is a way of behaving. It's innate to you. It's not outside you. So I don't think about teaching somebody a method. I think about teaching them the steps of forming, which is innate in everybody in their own particular way.